Moving north up toward the Boulder Power Lot, we have Andy Weinheimer, who is a veteran center.
Thank you, Michael. So I don't know one of Arthur's students has gone astray and left the realm of lobbying and final application. Trying to demonstrate him, he's just like Gary's fire suit. All I'm doing today is give a summary of what I've done my 30 years since I left Drive. A lot of fun, field demonstration, primarily making investments in aircraft. And I'll just give a brief overview of some of the projects I've been involved in. A little more flavor of the, type of work and then, growing with some personal reflection. So my career, at least in terms of the institutions, has been very simple. I came to RAS in 76, so I was a student of Arthur's and, only working in atmospheric electricity and cloud physics. I got my PhD in 1980 at postdoc a few years. And then I went to UCAR as a postdoc in the advanced study program and I've been there ever since. I bounced around a little bit at NCAR, initially in cloud physics and a little electrification, and then moved into making measurements from aircraft, first just humidity and then more chemical stuff after that. And Gary, I touched on this a bit, but I'll add a little more. My talk's not going to be too technical. This is more like the science of the as Gary mentioned, I learned from Dr. Chamberlain that ozone is being stratosphere by knocking apart O2 molecules, putting an oxygen atom to a molecule to make ozone. In stratosphere, that's done at 240 nanometers and shorter, and that's not available in the troposphere. But in troposphere, we have nitrogen dioxide, which is polarized at 400 nanometers. That's plenty of background light. So you can see in the top of the line, NO2 is polarized and makes an oxygen molecule. It's the ozone, but more often than not, that ozone, we know that nitrogen oxide is formed to heat up that ozone, and that result is no ozone production. But in the troposphere, we've got hydrocarbons that control the anthropogenic, some are natural, and it shows the oxidation scheme for methane, which is a methyl radical, which combines with O2, so a proxy radical. Proxy radical is something readily donated. An oxygen atom, the nitric oxide, and the O2, and that way we formed NO2 without consuming ozone, and that is that ozone production. There are similar reactions like this for all higher hard hydrocarbons and carbon monoxide itself. And so the bottom line is if you've got nitric oxide, we have hydrocarbons plus carbon monoxide and sulfide, you make ozone. Very dry, and that uses a very nice environment that has awful oxide. My dad is in that Tech 2000 project, and at that time, ethylene was fingerprinted as a culprit for very, very rapid. And so, what we're doing is being able to constrain the chemistry and the constrained model. We try to put together an aircraft payload that makes a comprehensive suite of compounds. Among them, not ozone, nitrogen compounds, dozens of hydrocarbons to measure. Now, high in product, a lot of compounds. HO2 is another proxy radical that can lead to ozone production. And in the last 10 years or so, a lot more work has been done recognizing the role of aerosols. A lot of these carbon compounds, hydrocarbons, end up getting oxidized and become much more flexible. So my role in these projects is to measure, has been to measure ozone and NO1 and NO2, a couple of key players in the process. And so how do we measure the ozone? This is a picture of our instrument in the lab right now. It just came off some airplanes that went wrong, and next month we can go back on that different airplane. To make measurements, we take advantage of reactions that occur in the atmosphere. Nitric oxide plus ozone gives us NO2, and 7% of that is formed is in an excited state. We measure the photons that come off of that, and count them using the diastereal thermal altitude, and measure ozone. We make ozone Add that ozone to the area there, and the signal goes up and falls in the night sky. Number two, the first public associate, this public associate, yeah, 400 millimeters, and we measure that signal. And we measure all what we do to the first. We have an ambient airstream that has an ambient ozone in it, and we add a little bit of nitric oxide to that. We get NO2 that can be luminescent. In the early days of my career, I did a lot of flying on the NASA BCA. I probably did something like 70 flights on that plane. And it's a huge airplane. It accommodates a very, very large extensive payload. The upper photo shows an upload of progress. We typically maintain an aisle down the center of the plane, and then typically there will be two seats and then a rack, and two seats and a rack, and two seats and a rack. So it's an operation, sit in front there, it's an operation. This is how it looks all for the mission manager station. The site doesn't need to go to the mission manager to coordinate the files. In the more recent years, since I talked about the Boston 5, how long ago, 18 years ago, more of my work has been done here. It's a much smaller aircraft, it's a less expensive payload, but it has very good capabilities, very long range. You get up to 48,000 feet. And with the smaller payload, there's much more pressure to have a harmless system. You see, no waste space on people. You have a lot more measurements if you don't fly on people. And that's our intent of the work having material, there's less need for us to actually do their job. Here's a typical layout. There are 16 stations, and in this one, there's a five in a row, just hardware and instruments, almost 60. Here are other aircraft I've been involved with. There's another fairly large payload. Very early in my career, still doing a little bit of pilot electrification. We have sailing at Antar. We had a pilot that would go up in the updraft of a thunderstorm, get up to 27,000 feet. We were able to measure the charge and on an individualized part of this form. There's one project we can ask B57 based out of Ellington. And that was in way off. It's stuck up in the bomb bay of it. And it was my first experience with doing autonomous measurements. But with a pilot in that pressure suit, coming in the back seat, basically just pressure is on. And then from a lot of flights in the NASA P3, and this plane flew in the project that Gary just described. And we were flying in that big spiral over the piece of ground. And often in these projects, there'll be two or three airplanes, so we all want to compare and measure. These are pictures from the NASA P3, which I was on at the time, of the entire airplane. We like to fly side and link it to link it to try to get the same air very important. If the atmosphere is often stratified, we can link it to link it and try to see the same air. A picture of me in my earlier days, and I included a picture of Mark Dalloff, former vice undergrad who worked with our group. And he's also he's not a professor at the university. It's funny, and Bostick was another guy from the UCAR, he's also in this area. Here are 27 projects or so that I've been involved with. And there are more acronyms, I can't remember what half of them are. But what you can notice is an increasing frequency of our deployments. We used to do, here I sort of quantify it with the running knee. In the early days, we would do a project every half a project a year or so. And now we're up to 2 to 3. It's also a sign of times so when people retire or end up doing something else, there's no money to hire new people. So our personnel, we're talking to breaking point, but we're hanging in. And again, we're able to do this because issues that we're not doing much, there's no time to make research on the development there. But plus a mile of demand supply. Here's the plot of acts of a dozen kind of represent areas we study. Mostly we're looking at Asia, a region of interest of late. And here's one particular, doing this is a contrast project, which we flew out of Guam and, a few months ago, 10 or 10 months ago. And the aim there was to conduct a transport. It's the tropical Western Pacific, which has the warm sea surface temperatures and dry convection at very high altitude. And can rapidly lift graphic compounds to an area of the atmosphere that normally don't capture. In particular, halogens can come out of the ocean. Here's one more project. This is phase P in blue. Here we were looking at the outflow of fluid air from primarily from China, we're finding out Hong Kong and Tokyo. And this is the conveyor belt analogy, which the model for how frontal systems flip the fluid air up to the upper level of the atmosphere and allow it to be transported. We see it coming in the west of the U.S. Another project, this was out of Key West. Here we measured the outflow of thunderstorms and trips and anvils between that fault line between Knox and Lightning. Connection to my old days. But Knox is a. The electrophysics for lightning is a very significant source of Knox and leads to overproduction. And otherwise, we can. One more project, this is Topsy. Tropical ozone production about the spring equinox. In the troposphere, there's a springtime maximum in ozone. It wasn't clear whether that was due to in situ chemistry in the troposphere or transport from the ground. Primary consensus was we did 7 round trips where we started at a home base in Colorado, went to Churchill, Manitoba, and up to Greenland, and north and then back. We did 7 loops like that over something like February to May. And to blow that up and zoom in on Houston, we saw what my track we flew last month. This is we can zoom in on Houston. And these are the slides that Gary just described, but now NASA can hear you. The crazy red fly. But we do at least, when we go 9 flights, each fly was 3 loops around the circuit, and each circuit is through a spiral over an intensive instrument of the ground side, but it's just on the ground and maybe it's a balloon profile. The effect of the setup. The acronym is a mouthful. Variety of information on surface conditions from column and vertically resolved observations are called the air ball. And the idea here is that satellites are used to assess airfall because it's really challenging for them to see and resolve what's happening close to the ground. For example, models on the stratosphere column will have to be protected out. Satellites sometimes have trouble. Say exactly how we're coming up on it. Okay. So this is just a schematic. We would take off from Ellington, fly to Dallas and do a missed approach, the airport there. Missed approach is normally when you're over populated areas, you have to go 1,000 feet. So if you find an airport to do a missed approach, you can extend your profile down to 100 feet. And we spiral up there, go to Smith Point, spiral down, fly to the ship channel, find what kind of temple. Some ships get pretty directly. And then fly up at the Moody Tower, which is invented in the upper range. And the P3 is indicated by the volunteer, and this is the beginning of 27,000 feet, which had a satellite style instrument that could mimic satellites. And there are also actual satellites up in the air. The idea is to try to the vertical column related to the ground face measurements and related to what satellite see. And this is the data Gary referred to, where on our first profile of mental flooring in South Houston, we saw pretty top of those, and a couple hours later, it was up over 80 degrees, and then it was well around. Next year, I look forward, or next summer, I look forward to you doing sort of the same sort of project you've been doing, instead of going all the wheels and that stuff, and then in our backyard, and then do the spirals, and tie network in the Denver area, and at the same time, we'll also be on the Enterprise Unit 30, mission for the half state type of size, but of course, to the broader context of more localized measurements in that project. And I'll hold just one comment, if you'll all take some personal comments. Ross has been good to me and my family. But my sisters came to Rice when I was still here. And that's how it's on for me. And then, so, and they both carried Rice guys. So when there's a family gathering, talking about Rice. To my surprise, I think I should have been surprised, but 5 years ago when my son was in Kentucky College, he chose Rice. And this long story short, he ended up in like a college, master of, Maurice's been running the show there forever, and Reggie, and all the lots, so that's been nice to connect to me.